and welcome to What a Scream, the podcast where I, your host, Oh Golly Miss Dolly, chats with a special guest every week about horror films, and in particular, ones that embody a certain theme or subject that I have previously randomly chosen. So this week, the theme that I chose to do was Tom Savini. Now, he is a master in the horror world when it comes to special effects makeup, and he's worked on some of the most well-known films with some of the most loved directors. So Thomas Vincent Savini was born on November the 3rd, 1946, and he's an actor, special effects makeup artist, a stunt performer, and a film director. So he does it all. He's a good all-rounder. He did special effects on George A. Romero's Martin, Dawn of the Dead, Day of the Dead, Creepshow, and Monkey Shines, as well as Friday the 13th, Parts 1 and 4, Maniac, The Burning, The Prowler, and Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2. So as you can see, he's done a lot of zombie and splatter films. That is his specialty, although Creepshow was one where he really got to show off with his kind of creature modeling, being a bit more kind of imaginative with fantasy like effects. As a boy, his earliest and biggest inspiration was Lon Chaney Sr. And he started practicing special effects on all the kids in the neighborhood. As a young adult, he then went on to enlist in the army. And during the Vietnam War, he was a photographer. And as you'll kind of hear me and my special guest chatting, that was where he kind of found, he found that by looking at these things and by thinking about how he could recreate this, it kind of, it dulled somewhat of the shock for him. As I'm sure it was horrific to see that in real life, but seeing and looking at it and saying, thinking, you know, how could I do this in movies? It kind of helped shield him a little bit. So a teacher to Tom Savini was the infamous special effects makeup artist Dick Smith, who did a lot of groundbreaking work on films like The Exorcist. And it's great to see this camaraderie between special effects makeup artists. You'd think they'd be very precious about their secrets of the trade, but apparently Dick Smith was more than willing to help Tom Savini out with, you know, creating special effects blood. I think that's lovely to see. You know, there's no point hogging all these secrets to yourself. It doesn't do anyone any good. So he then went on to set up the Tom Savini Special Makeup Effects Program in Pennsylvania to help educate special effects makeup artists. So again, it's this cycle of giving back to future generations of special effects makeup artists. So this week, my special guest is Zoe Smith, aka Zobo with a Shotgun. They review films under Zobo with a Shotgun. They have their own horror podcast, and they are extreme cinema enthusiasts. And they have recently just set up Ghouls Magazine. Check that out online. It's an online magazine that kind of gives a voice to women, to non-binary people, members of the LGBTQIA community, as well as BAME. And we have a great chat about two particular Tom Savini films. They're both slashers. They're both from the 80s. One is 1980s, Friday the 13th, and 1981's The Burning. So I would like to introduce to the podcast Zoe Smith. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you so much for having me on.
Oh, no, thank you so much for agreeing to come on and chat horror with me. How are you getting on in your corner of the world with this horror film of a universe we're living in right now?
Yeah, I mean, it's not been the best time for any of us, has it? But to be honest, yeah, getting on well. I'm learning to bake, and I spend a lot of time, you know, just hanging out on the floor with my cats. So I guess in that way, I'm not going to complain.
Yeah, that does sound like an amazing use of time, baking and cats.
What more could you want?
Right. I have recently decided, just for some random reason, I've recently decided to take up embroidery and cross stitch.
Oh, nice.
But you know, those kind of like embroidery and cross stitch that say like gobshite in the middle of like loads of lovely flowers, like that kind of hail Satan and, you know, all this kind of stuff, because, you know, I couldn't just do it normally. So for anyone who doesn't know who you are, would you like to introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about what you do?
Yes. So for anyone that doesn't know, I'm called Zoe, and I guess I came to the horror world. Most people know me as Zobo from Zobo With A Shotgun. So I've got a website, zobowithashotgun.com, which I started far too long ago now. I don't even want to admit how many years ago that came around. And that was just my little corner of the world, I guess, to talk about extreme horror. I'm a big fan of extreme, very nasty, very controversial films. And I was like, not a lot of people seem to review these. Yeah. There's a reason why. So I thought I would give my shot at that. Then that kind of turned into a podcast of the same name, now into YouTube of the same name, even though I've slacked so hard on that lately. And then more recently, I have launched Ghouls Magazine, which is an online magazine written from the female perspective. And we have an awesome group of writers, both women writers and non-binary writers, for the site, who provide, I think, just like a really unique perspective on the horror genre. It's not all extreme. It's a little bit more mainstream. We've got some nice normal kind of horror on there. Yeah. Obviously, I do write a lot of extreme on there, as much as I've been told, you know, maybe tone it down, maybe write for, you know, people that like to watch normal horror films.
Normal, like family-friendly horror film.
Yeah, apparently a Serbian film is not a family-friendly film, you know.
Far from it.
Yeah, I mean, I mean, this is maybe why I don't have a family. But yeah, so that's about it. Just, yeah, always nattering about horror somewhere or other.
And what was your inspiration to start Ghouls Magazine?
Well, I mean, having been in the horror industry for quite a while, I think there are so many amazing perspectives on it. But I think as a critic, one of the things I really noticed was that, unfortunately, it seems to be white males get most of the attention or have the biggest dominance in the sphere.
No, never.
Right? Shocker. And I was like, do you know what? I guess in a way it was a bit of anger came from the fact that I just kept reading articles on films like I Spit on Your Grave, written by men, who were like, do you know what? This is so demeaning for women. It's derogatory. A woman would never watch this. And I was like, hang on a second. Have you actually asked one, or is that your thought? And, you know, like loads of women I know, for instance, love I Spit on Your Grave. For me, it's one of the most empowering, liberating films. I was like, don't, you know, shun our voice. Don't try and shut that down because you have your opinion. You can have it, but, you know, what is a female's perspective on a rape revenge film? Yeah. That's, for me, that's kind of like so interesting. And, you know, through doing Sober With A Shotgun, I've just connected with so many amazing people, and not just women, you know, like I said, non-binary, LGBTQ people as well, like so many different communities, BAME, you know, the list goes on of different perspectives. And obviously I can't represent everyone, but I thought, let's bring together some voices and create, you know, carve out another space for them to kind of be heard about. Because yeah, I just don't want to hear those blokes banging on anymore.
It's just like, I'm bored now.
Yeah, I was like, okay, I don't want to hear, and I don't want to see you anymore. Yeah. So let's bring the ladies to the forefront. Yeah.
And it's so strange because in my experience, it's mainly women who are fanatical about horror, who are like massively into horror as movies and as imagery, and also kind of dissecting horror. They really want to dissect it. It's women, it's members of the queer community. They just all kind of really connect with it. So it's kind of strange how it's the male voice that is the most, not strange, because obviously it's the male voice that's going to be the loudest. But do you find that, especially with your love of extreme horror, that it is women who love it a bit more than men?
I do, actually. I mean, obviously, extreme is it's so niche that like it took me a long time to find other women that enjoyed it. And I think there was a time where I was like, am I seriously the only one? But what I found, and you know, kind of echoing what you said, is the women that I have found, they love extreme, but they also have such an intelligent viewpoint on it as well. And yeah, I think, you know, there's so many women now that I've discovered, they're like, oh, well, I love a controversial movie. I love, you know, something like I Spit on Your Grave or something even worse, like Necromantic or Cannibal Holocaust. And I speak to them and there's so many different like ways that they look at it and so many ways to dissect it. And I think for me, I'm just like, that gets me so excited. But yeah, there are surprisingly so many women that love extreme horror, and I guess for so many different reasons as well.
Yeah. What are your reasons for loving it so much?
I used to tell myself it was because I had a lot of problems in the head. but my therapist says that's not true. Yeah, I mean, I got into extreme horror just after my mum passed away very long time ago. And it was, for me, it was like a really cathartic experience. Yeah. It's such a, I guess it's such a, something that's so steeped in trauma and violence and, you know, body horror and the visceral. And it is often, you know, it shocks you. You kind of watch it, you go, I mean, the amount of times I put on films and I was like, oh, I'm going to, I was like, maybe I should turn that off and have a breather, come back tomorrow, you know, watch it in bits. But I think it was that like emotional response was so, especially when going through like grief and trauma, that emotional response was so different and so kind of like provocative. I found it such an incredible kind of shock to the system. And for a long time, you know, I found it really difficult to deal with emotions, but I felt through watching those films, I could kind of channel it into them. And, you know, there's sometimes when you're just like in a really bad head state and, you know, you're watching someone get tortured and you kind of go, this helped, you know, this just kind of, it could be worse. I could be in their position. And I think since then, it's almost kind of like become a very bizarre comfort to me, which... And I only really watch them by myself. I don't watch extreme films with, and partially because a lot of people don't want to watch them with me, but also because, it's kind of like my, you know, it's just my like little comfort that I have where I'm like, okay, I'm just going to watch this person get like their feet cut off because that'll make me feel good.
I find with horror, like you said, it's so, you know, if you've gone through a kind of a certain trauma, no matter what it is, horror is like a safe space to explore those feelings in a controlled environment. You know, this is going to make me sound like such a psycho, and I don't mean it to come across like this, but if you're so angry and you're so just desperate at the world, you can watch someone being stalked by a serial killer, a slasher, everyone, you know, blood everywhere. You don't have to go out and do that in real life. It's like you live through someone else's perspective. And I did have a psychologist on for my very first episode, and she said that watching horror films actually releases serotonin into our bodies. So there is actually a biological science behind it all as to why we like it. We're not just freaks.
I'm going to use that next time someone says to me, but why do you watch horror films? I'm like, Well, actually, there's a very good episode you can listen to, and it's explained in more detail that it is scientific.
I've only just recently got into extreme, because I'm always like I'm a bit of a scaredy cat sometimes when it comes to the really, really extreme stuff. So I started getting into it. I did watch Necromantic when I was about 20 in college.
Yeah.
And I remember thinking it was just this, like, I'd heard it built up so much. And when I watched it, I was like, oh, it's just a beautiful art house film. It's so beautiful.
See, I always say to people, I'm like, it is a love movie. And they're like, are you sure? I'm like, yes, it's heartbreaking.
It's an extremely twisted love movie.
Exactly, you know, and we've all got our own kinks, I guess.
Yeah. I recently watched Martyrs for the first time.
Oh, wow. What did you think?
Maybe I was expecting a lot more. I didn't think it got me as much. It's a brilliant film, don't get me wrong. And yes, it is gory and visceral. And it does have like this amazing deeper meaning. And I really went into the research of it afterwards.
Yeah.
And that's what I loved about that movie. But it didn't shock me as much as I thought it would. Maybe that's just me.
No, I know what you mean, actually. Like, I mean, like you said, it's a like a stunning film. Like, it's it is so powerful, but I don't think it's quite as shocking as a lot of other films. I really like it, but you know, like, it's not my favorite new French extremity film. I think I like loads of other ones a bit more. I guess it just kind of, like, I don't know, it's just that one, isn't it, that everyone kind of goes, oh, but have you seen Martyrs? And it's almost like you're weird if you go, yeah, it's all right. Like, it's not people are like, how dare you.
Do you find yourself desensitized to things?
I actually I did my university dissertation on looking at, like, whether we become desensitized to violence over time through horror films, and I discovered that, you know, a lot of people actually realized as well that they were becoming desensitized, and that was almost a point where people kind of went, oh, I better stop, like, I better not, because I'm watching a certain film and I'm going, oh, I don't find it that bad anymore. And I think I've absolutely become more desensitized. You know, I can sit and watch a film with friends and they're all going, whoa, and I'm just like, oh yeah, that was horrible. I'm like, oh gosh. I'm just kind of sat here like, it's not too bad. But there's still things that do get me. So I always, I'm pleasantly surprised when I go, no, that's too much for me. I'm like, there's still something there, a soul.
Just tiny, tiny little one. For me, it's anything to do with feet. If I see something with feet, I'm like, nope, I'm gone, I'm out, goodbye.
You don't like feet, or is it just
violence towards feet?
It's very specific.
It is. So, you know that bit in Hostel where the guy gets his Achilles tendons?
Yes.
I walked out of that. I was like, no, not dealing with this. Absolutely not.
Yeah, that's a pretty gnarly scene.
Yeah. I mean, skin someone alive, you know, flay their lungs out like angel wings, whatever. No, don't touch the feet.
That's amazing.
Yeah. So how did you get into horror? Let's go all the way back. What was the very first horror film that you saw and you were like, this is for me?
The very first horror film I saw was, and I've been begging my dad to let me watch it, was he had The Evil Dead, and he had a super, I'm not sure you can get them anymore, but the cover was like this rubber Necronomicon.
Oh, wow.
And I remember always like picking it up and you could kind of put like your finger in its mouth and touch its eyes. And I was always like playing with it and I was like, what is this? And the artwork in there as well is just incredible, and I was obsessed with it. And then one Halloween I was like, please, and my dad was like, all right, you can watch it. And I was like, holy shit, it's happening. And I was terrified. I remember like it turning off and I was like, no, I was like, I'm never going to the woods. I was like, there's stuff happening and I hate it. But then after that I was just like, that was incredible. I was like, I've never seen anything like that before in my life.
Yeah.
And yeah, it just kickstarted me off on, and you know, it's I rewatched The Evil Dead a couple mm-hmm. of Halloweens ago. I went to see it alongside the Texas Chainsaw Massacre at the cinema, and yeah. I was like, even though some of the effects are, yes, okay, they're a little yeah. bit questionable, I was like, it still has like such a power. I yeah. was like, oh, it just reminds me like how excited I was as like yeah. Because I think I was about 13, so relatively older, but yeah, yeah. I was just like, holy shit, this is so good.
Yeah, I think The Evil Dead's absolutely brilliant. It's funny, it was the first film that I introduced my little sister to. You know how really? People always say, oh, I have older siblings that introduced me. I was the older sibling. And the very first film I made her watch was Evil Dead. And she must have been about 10 or 11 at the time. And it's like this massive joke amongst us now that, you know, she turned to me and was like, what's that tree doing? I had to like explain what the tree was doing.
Yeah, that one kind of got me as well. I was like, I think every camping trip, you suddenly kind of sat there going, I've got a different view of branches nowadays.
Serious phobia of trees.
Right.
So let's chat about our theme for this week, which I picked out was Tom Savini. So how do you feel about Tom Savini? What do you know about him?
I mean, I know who Tom Savini is.
Yeah.
For me, I know him as a special effects artist. I know him as the kind of guy from the 80s who was, you know, working yeah. on some of the biggest, I guess, slasher productions and with some of the biggest names like George Romero. But I've never really delved into much of his work,
yeah.
I would say, and I didn't know, and I only discovered when you chose this topic, yeah. I didn't know that he had actually directed some films himself. I had no idea, and I also didn't know he had acted in, because to be fair, I had not seen most of them. So
okay.
So I was like, okay, this is, yeah, I was like, this is exciting, because I know he's huge in the horror yeah. world. Like, he's a big name. But yeah, just kind of one of my blind spots, actually. So, yeah, you've got me opened up to something a bit new for me.
That's good. See, I always knew about, like, Tom Savini being a big kind of name in the special effects community. And then, obviously, I'd seen him in From Dusk Till Dawn. As yeah, the bike, he always seems to play bikers. But after I picked out this topic and I went back and like researched everything, he does everything. Like, he's a stuntman, he's a director, obviously does special effects, he teaches special effects as well. And he just seems to be this like really nice guy. He's like a bodybuilder as well, just 73 year old bodybuilder.
maybe he's actually, that's bloody cool, isn't it?
Just a little bit, yeah. And when he was enlisted in the army, he went to Vietnam and he was the photographer, and that's how he kind of learnt how, you know, the human body, the anatomy acts when it's been blown up or cut off. And it's quite grim, actually, isn't it?
That's horrific. I think he kind of went, what can I do with this PTSD? Yeah, I know.
That's exactly what he did. He was like, the only way that I could not kind of realize the full horror of everything was if I looked at that body part and was like, how would they make that in the movies?
Wow. I mean, that's quite incredible, actually.
Yeah.
And I guess that's maybe why his effects are so good, because yeah. he's got, unfortunately, the real thing to compare it to.
Yes. But yeah, he just seems like this great guy who's like constantly working, and you know, I think he's great. I feel like I'd want him to be my granddad.
Oh, can you imagine the stories like going round for like a cup of tea, and he's like, well, first of all, obviously you'd start with all the Vietnam stories, and yeah. you'd go, you know, your parents would come in and go, that's a bit much, stop there. But then you get all the stories about, you know, special effects and who yeah. he's worked with.
Yeah. Oh, and imagine damn. Like your Halloween discos at school and being like, granddad,
so good.
I need my costume to be made. And, you know, you come in with a severed limb. Or
and they send you home because yeah. like you were scaring the rest of the children.
They have to call your grandfather into the school office.
And then it's Tom Savini and they're all like, yeah, fair yeah, enough. Okay. All right, we'll let you off.
So the film that you decided to pick, The Burning, do you want to introduce it and give us a short synopsis on the film?
Yes. So The Burning, the reason I chose this one was a bit of a random one. A guy I used to talk to on Twitter a very, 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 very long time ago, his handle was The Burning. And I always just kind of went, oh, I should watch The Burning at some point. Yeah. That was probably like 8 years ago. Never watched The Burning. And then when you picked this out, I was like, right, it's time. Let's yeah. watch The Burning. I was like, to that, you know, guy that I don't know where he is in the world now, but I'm finally watching it.
Yeah.
So The Burning is, it starts with a group of five kind of like young boys, teenagers, and they are harassing this guy called Old Man Cropsy, who's just having like little nap, bless him. They wake him up and they decide to play a prank on him, where they put like a little skull with some worms and some candles. Nothing that bad, but he yeah. absolutely freaks out at it, which is incredible. Freaks out, kind of knocks everything over, mm-hmm. and the whole cabin that he's in lights on fire. Mm-hmm. He lights on fire, runs outside. The boys, they basically watch him burn alive. It's quite distressing actually yeah. for the first kind of like 2 minutes of the film.
Yeah.
Then I'm not sure how many years it is later. I think it's 5 years later. It's at summer camp, of course. Where else would you have an 80s slasher movie?
Summer right? camp. Nobody went to summer camp in the late 80s after that. They were like, nope, you know what?
Right. And I think here in the UK, I'm not even sure if it's like a thing for us, like summer camp. I was like, you can go to the pond with your mates yeah. after school, but that's about it.
Yeah.
So they're at summer camp and we've got obviously a group of young teens doing what teens do, frolicking around, wanting to have sex with everyone and everything.
Yeah.
And one by one, they start getting stalked and murdered by, you've guessed it, it's got to be Old Man Cropsy. How he's come back, we don't know, but right. he's back. And that's pretty much the premise.
Yeah, I mean, it's not exactly rocket science, is it? It's very much a tried and tested formula.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Definitely. So
they went, we know what works. Let's yeah. do it again.
Yeah. So, I mean, The Burning, it was unfortunately written and produced by Harvey Weinstein. And it got a bit of a reputation for him being a bit leery on it, obviously, him being him. And it's a shame that it's kind of marred by that.
And the thing is, though, I think that also comes through in the film.
Definitely.
As well.
Yeah.
It's, I mean, I'm not a big fan of slashers at all.
Yeah.
So for me, watching this, you know, it's probably my least favorite genre. But I you know, there's definitely some elements of slashers to have fun with.
Yeah.
But I think my biggest problem of this, I was like, they do realize when they make this film that not every shot needs to show tits or yeah. ass. I was yeah. like, I mean, I think there's a particular scene where she's taking a shower. I was
yes.
like, we really didn't need to go down here and look yeah. up there. And the soap, I was like, no one takes a shower like that.
No.
I was like, it does not look like that. Like,
absolutely
yeah, it does.
Not.
It feels quite leery the whole way
yeah.
throughout, which I think was probably my main problem with it.
Yeah. I mean, films don't usually make me feel quite uneasy. And maybe because I knew about the Harvey Weinstein thing, it made me feel really, really uneasy and just like, bleh.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, I actually didn't know that it was by him because, as you can tell, I did not didn't research into the film, just went, I'm just going to whack this one on. But yeah, I guess it actually makes it even worse, doesn't it? Like, to know that. But I think, I mean, I think the sad thing is a lot of the films similar to The Burning, unfortunately, I think a lot of films from that era suffered from them coming across as just, you know, these male gaze films with shots that, you know, I think we can look back on now and go, did we really need that? Does it really add anything into it? And also, you know, it just, a lot of them just make like young boys look like these disgusting sex monsters, which, you know, I don't think they were quite like that. Like,
definitely.
I'm sure some of those actors probably look back on it and go, oh, fuck it now, that's horrible, isn't it?
And it's so strange because the slasher genre, you know, it always has the final, well, more than often, it has the final girl, and, you know, we see her fighting out against the kind of the big bad. And so it's kind of strange that we have this, like, comparison between is it feminist to have, you know, a strong leading final girl, but it's also super misogynistic and, you know, sex negative as well, because, you know, anyone who dies is because they had sex. You know, it's kind of a strange thing to have within that slasher genre.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. I think, you know, so many of us have like that kind of conflict, don't we? We're all like, the final girl. And then you're like, but all the other girls who were probably just as strong and awesome died because they kissed a boy who a lot of the times, and we see this in The Burning very heavily, are like, no, John, I don't want to kiss you. And he's like, we're going to do it anyway. And they go, all right. And then they're murdered. I don't know. It just feels a bit like, a bit awkward, doesn't it? It just doesn't feel quite right.
It's almost like a fake kind of feminism, you know, strong female, because you can only live if you're pure and good and, you know, don't have sex. And it's like, well, I'm fucked.
I was like, I survived, I'm just not in the movie, like, I'm already dead, just
not at all. So it is based on the urban legend of Cropsey, which I don't know if you know about, but it was this child abduction monster in New York that actually turned out to be a real serial killer or a real child abductor. So I find that kind of creepy as well, with their intentions with the film.
Jesus Christ, this one just gets worse.
I know, right? And it wasn't like teenagers that the real Cropsey was after. It was like young children. Oh, and it's gosh. Like, why would you want to take, like, why? If the film isn't about that, then why would you want to almost hail Cropsey as this, like, hard dumb-by victim? Yeah. It's kind of weird, isn't it?
That is... Yeah, because in this, he's obviously, like, not super bad, but I felt a little bit bad for him. Because, you know, the fact that he's like, burning alive in the first few scenes with, you know, at the hands of the boys who are almost like kind of tormenting him, and you're like, oh, poor Cropsey, you know, and you almost in a way you're like, yeah, fair enough for him coming back and kind of getting his redemption. But now I know that that is based off that. Yeah, it's almost like, why did they choose that? I just don't get it.
Like, I kind of feel that this whole movie is just like the only kind of, I mean, it's a great slasher film if you don't kind of read as much into it as I have, but I kind of feel like it was just like a film for Tom Savini to show off, which is great. And moving on to his kind of contribution to the film, how did you feel about the gore and the violence?
I thought actually the gore and the violence was done really, really well. It was probably one of the only things I liked about the film, if I'm honest. I think, you know, the burn effect on Old Man Cropsey was fantastic. I think that was really well done. And I did like the kills. I thought in comparison to a lot of films of that time and even films nowadays where the effects are just so poor, you know, where it's like ketchup pouring out of like God knows what they've made it out of. But you can definitely see that Tom Savini's got, you know, he is a master of his trade, and he's got it down to a T when it comes to those effects. Because, you know, he's very good at slit throats, I thought.
Oh, gotcha. Yeah.
Those looked incredibly real in this film. And probably all those, you know, as you mentioned, all those war days where he went, oh, I've seen that one. I'll crack that in there. But yeah, I do think Tom Savini's work in this is you know, definitely one of the more hailable points to it. But like you said, it does also feel like that's maybe, you know, kind of like a reason to show off in this film. Yeah. And probably, the only kind of like commendable thing where you can go, that was good.
Yeah. I mean, the burns on Old Man Cropsey, he only did that in like 3 days because he had so much time constraints. And and apparently he couldn't get it the way he wanted because of the time constraints. So he had to make it more melty rather than burny. But it still looks incredibly real.
Yeah, it looks so good.
I assume that skin melts to a certain point as well rather than just burn.
I mean, I would think so. Like, surely it has to, because it kind of has to like come off of your thing. And I mean, I used to have like a Halloween mask, and it was like the skin like burnt and melting. So I was going to say, oh, maybe we should try it, but no, let's not.
Any willing victims out there?
let's find out.
But yeah, the thing I like about Tom Savini in this film as well, he seems quite DIY punk about his art. You know, he's like, what kind of random household object can I use to make it seem as if there's blood squirting everywhere? And, you know, I've read things that like he would fill condoms up with fake blood and that would create the massive explosion kind of blood.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
And I'm like, how did you find that out? What were you doing?
He has a very disgruntled ex-wife somewhere that was like, I did not appreciate that in the bedroom.
But yeah, there is one kill that I actually really liked, and it was the one where he's on the raft and he gets the shears and he sticks it into the guy's throat.
Yes.
And it's all like that. I really liked that one because I really love the way he seems to kind of do this in a lot of his films where he gets like a fake body and neck, and then he has the actor like poke their head through the hole and pretend to be like, ah. I mean, it's very obvious, you can see where the real ends and the fake begins, but I just think it's great.
There were some I think there's also the shears in the woods when one of them, I can't remember the character names, but he's up against the tree and he kind of gets him, and I think the way that it goes into the body as well, it definitely, you know, I think there's a lot of times when you see special effects and you're like, you can kind of see it off screen, like, you know, they've kind of positioned it so it almost looks, whereas I think Tom Savini went, no, let's, like you said, let's build the fake kind of head and torso and make sure we really get those shears going in there.
The great thing about Tom Savini, and in this film, it doesn't cut away at any point.
Yeah.
You know, like a lot of films, they'll cut away to make it seem as if someone's just been stabbed. Whereas with Tom Savini effects, you get the everything all in up in your face. Like, you know exactly like how that shear is going in and the noise and the resistance. Because also I've seen a lot of films where someone's getting stabbed and it's like butter. And you're like, that's not how the body would respond. Like, not at all. So I really appreciate the fact that they don't cut away with the gore.
Yeah, and also, you know, I mean, as I said, you know, I love gore. Like, gore's my kind of thing. And I think without the gore, a lot of these films, they would lack kind of a bit of substance, especially something like The Burning. It's, you know, essentially the majority of The Burning is just teenage kids talking about bullshit, doing nothing, swimming, and, you know, kind of playing games or eating food. There's not really much going on, or maybe having sex. That also happens a lot, which, fair enough. You've got, you know, whatever, 20 young teens together. What else are you going to do? So I think if you took away seeing the gore in all of its beauty, that then you kind of be going, okay, right. There's really nothing else here. So I like the fact that we get to see the gore quite a lot.
I definitely think, obviously, because of its predecessor Halloween or Black Christmas, they rely a lot on atmospheric kind of tension and terror, whereas The Burning doesn't have any of that. And so
there's no mood or atmosphere to it.
They were very lucky to have Tom Savini.
I'm not sure how they pulled that one off, to be honest, but you know, I'm sure there was a good paycheck somewhere in there.
Absolutely. So when The Burning was released, it was kind of the victim of a lot of cutting by the MPAA in America and the BBFC in the UK. And I read, though, that the uncut version was accidentally released in the UK and it became a video nasty, and it was like a crime to have it or to like show it.
Have the oh, Jesus Christ. It's mad, isn't it? The things that back then they got so uppity about. Yeah. I mean, I think when you watch The Burning now, it's pretty tame in comparison to a lot of things.
Just a little bit. It's kind of strange because in Britain, they were very into, like, you know, being proper and not a lot of sex or gore. Whereas in Ireland, the films that got banned here are ones that had religious aspects to it. So the Exorcist was banned. Alice, Sweet Alice was banned here.
Oh, yeah, I really like that one.
Yeah. And it's just hilarious that when you read about the British banning compared to the Irish banning, it's hilarious because it plays into these stereotypes of the British being, you know, the stiff upper lip, the very, you know, polite kind of gentleman, and the Irish being Catholic crazy.
And they were like, no, you must not say about that about Catholics. How dare you? Yeah. And here we're like, oh gosh, someone had a kiss on screen. Better not.
So would you recommend The Burning to someone who was perhaps getting into special effects or was a fan of Tom Savini?
I think if someone was getting into special effects and they were interested in Tom Savini, I would recommend it on that front. Yeah. If I'm recommending it as a general film, I would say there's so many films out there that you could spend your time on that are not The Burning.
Anything but The Burning.
Yeah.
And it's strange because it's come a bit of a cult classic. And I can't figure out why.
No, so I mean, when I tweeted about, I kind of said, like, you know, I was like, I was like, that was a bit shit, really, wasn't it? And that really riled up some people on the internet. They were like, how dare you talk about The Burning? And I was like, have you seen it? Or are you just saying that? I was like, because it's really not very good. But hey, you know, who am I to say? I'm not.
Each to their own. So I, like you, I would only kind of recommend it if someone was getting into special effects, but I'd be like, just ignore all the film. In fact, just fast forward to all the kills. You don't have to watch the film. You don't have to, you know, follow the storyline. It's awful. You know, if you want to pause on the boobs, grand, but just know that it was done by a rapist. Just saying.
Yeah. I like it. I like that view.
Yeah. So the film I chose was another slasher film. It seems that seems to be, apart from zombie films, it's Tom Savini's favorite kind of thing to do. Although I saw in an interview that he said he actually loved doing Creep Show because it gave him the imagination and the creativity rather than just how can I kill people.
Because I guess Creepshow is different, isn't it? Because it's got, it's kind of like monsters and lore, and it's it's definitely more imaginative than just, I guess, with straight up kills, you know what you're going in for, don't you? It's kind of like, right, someone's getting stabbed again, and he probably goes, this is like the millionth stabbing I've done. Whereas I guess maybe making those more kind of elaborate pieces is fun.
So I definitely recommend for people to go watch Creepshow for that. But the reason I picked Friday the 13th were because Tom Savini actually created Jason. He created the look of Jason. He was the one that suggested Jason show up at the end of the film. They weren't going to put that sequence in, you know, where she's lying on the raft and Jason comes up. They weren't going to put that in. And Tom Savini said, you have to put it in. And so they did. And he was also the one that killed off Jason in Final Chapter, which wasn't the final chapter, but it was meant to be the final chapter.
It never is with these films.
Like the killer, they keep coming back. So Friday the 13th, it is from the 1980. Well, it's 1980, so it's a year before The Burning, directed by Sean S. Cunningham. And again, it is a group of teenagers, camp counselors at Camp Crystal Lake, getting ready to open for the summer, and they are being hunted by a mysterious killer. So again, pretty much the exact same plot as The Burning.
Pretty much, yeah. Very similar.
Very similar. Obviously, spoiler alert if you haven't seen this and you don't know already, although how could you not know? Turns out it is not Jason Voorhees that is the killer. It is his mother, Pamela, which is kind of strange because at one point, doesn't she have like really like man hands, hairy knuckles? And you're like, really?
Also, I'm pretty sure there's also shots where it's coming across from the point of view where she's about 6 foot as well. And I was like, pretty sure she's not quite that tall. But hey, you know, I don't know what kind of shoes she's wearing. So
maybe
I
she
can't
had platform willy boots on.
That seems like an awesome idea. Stylish and practical.
Right. unless you try and run and then you're just ankles fucked.
Yeah.
So not that practical when you're running after teenagers trying to kill them.
But they, I mean, none of them seem to be particularly fast or concerned.
Right.
So they were all kind of dilly-dallying around in the dark, in the nighttime, in the woods. Yeah. And I'm like, okay. Yeah. You know, I was like, I personally wouldn't, but fine.
So I asked this question. Me and my little sister, we do a little review episode every week. And I asked this question about You Should Have Left. And I said, do horror movies exist in these universes? Otherwise, why are they arson around? Like, obviously, it wouldn't make a great film. But like, why wouldn't you hop up out of there and, you know, sprint as fast as you can?
But that's the thing, isn't it? It's like us, we've all seen horror movies. And I think it's why when we watch these movies, we're like, why are you going in the basement? Why did you go alone? Why didn't you grab a weapon? Why are you only in your pants and your bare feet? Why? And you just kind of go, yeah, exactly. Do they have they seen horror movies? And maybe they don't have them. Or maybe they just like to ignore all the warning signs.
It's like when this whole pandemic started and there was a study done that said horror fans are better equipped to deal with a pandemic than normal people are. We're like, it's grand. I mean,
as soon as it started, I was like, right, let's just prep for zombie apocalypse just in case. There's a chance.
Yeah, I mean, we started watching The Walking Dead when we were in it. And I was like, you know, just as a bit of a research.
Yeah. You need to know what's coming. You know, I mean, some people have had the vaccine. We haven't left it long enough to know what's. So there's still time.
You're like, I need a baseball bat and a machete.
Don't worry, I've read it. They're just over there.
So back to Friday the 13th. It was it's kind of, especially if you watch these two films side by side, a lot of the kills are very similar. In fact, they're identical. So there is, you know, there's the axe to the face. There is the arrow that penetrates Kevin Bacon's character, goes up through the bunk bed.
Yeah.
And that was another fake body, Kevin Bacon's head through the bed. And then obviously Mrs. Voorhees' decapitation scene.
I do love that scene.
Yes, me too. Again, it doesn't cut away.
No, I was, yeah. Do you know what? I was actually surprised. I was like, oh, I was like, didn't remember it being quite so on it constantly. Because
a lot of the time when someone's decapitated, you see the knife going across and then the head just bouncing on the floor.
Yeah.
Whereas this, you get full, like full on view of the neck, of the arteries, everything. You're like, oh, that's what's in there. So yeah, apparently he developed these kills for Friday the 13th, and then the burning was like his further development on these kind of, it was like his learning process on Friday the 13th, and the burning was his perfection process.
Which seems, it seems like the wrong way around to do it. it seems like a bit of a waste to go, let's make it better on the burning.
Yeah.
And then the burning comes out and they go, I'm sure everyone went, yeah, well, the effects are better. But, but I think, I mean, to be honest, I actually think that, and perhaps it's because it's a better film.
Yeah.
I think that the kills and the effects seem, regardless of, you know, at the actualities of them from Savini's point of view, they seem to me better. They seem far more kind of gruesome, and the, like, for instance, the arrow through the neck, I thought that was fantastic.
Yeah.
I absolutely adored that kill. I was like, oh my God, this is, I was like,
it's one of my favorite kill scenes. Yeah.
It's so nasty. Yeah. Like,
yeah. And it's so, like, I think it almost preys on a fear of, like, we're all lying in bed, you know, we all go to bed.
Right.
What if there was something underneath our bed? And you know how usually when we have the fear of underneath the bed, you know, someone looks under the bed and there's someone there and they jump out. Whereas this one is, you're just lying perfectly still. You know, you've just had a bit of sex. You're getting those rush of endorphins. All of a sudden this arrow comes up.
Right. Yeah. No, it was like, I watched it and then, you know, you get into bed and you're like, let's just double check that no one's going to spear me through the throat in the nighttime. Yeah, it's, I mean, it did, you know, it did kind of say to me, I was like, just never have sex or sleep.
Yeah.
I was like, just stand up awake constantly. Now I'll get you.
Another thing I think that kind of adds to the kind of gore and the violence is it's a voyeuristic viewpoint as well. We see it a lot from the killer's point of view, and so it's kind of a glorified gory killing, which I kind of imagine it would be for a killer.
Yeah, I mean, I think I really liked that it was from that perspective, because I think it actually makes it I guess in a way it makes it harder to watch, you know, and it reminded me of a lot of, you know, a lot of those extreme films that I like. They kind of, you know, it's often like found footage. You are almost in the killer's perspective. So yeah, you get all of the gore in its glory because you're looking from that. And I guess, like you said, you know, of course they'd look at everything. I mean, that's part of the fun for them, isn't it? When they kill, I'm sure no murderer. I mean, I would love to see it. You know, like a murderer stabs someone and goes, oh, they're not looking.
Oh, I'm gonna faint.
Which would make a hilarious movie, though.
Wouldn't it? Quick, copyright it. Write it down somewhere. So another reason why I chose Friday the 13th, because I wanted to kind of bookend it with the final chapter, because Tom Savini did not want to do 2 and 3.
Yeah.
That's why he did The Burning Man. Not The Burning Man. He didn't do The Burning Man. He did The Burning. That's why he wanted to do The Burning, because he didn't want to do 2 and 3, because he couldn't find a logical reason as to why Jason would start killing people. But then when they told him that they were going to end it in the final chapter, he said, I want to kill Jason because I birthed him.
So they basically, so first of all, my takeaway from that is I like Tom Savini even more, because he also doesn't get the, I mean, why is Jason killing people? Who knows? And I'm glad that he also agreed with that.
Yeah.
But poor sod. They basically lied to him to get him to come and kill Jason, and then went, oh, we're going to bring him back again.
Surprise!
You reckon he was sat there reading the news just like, how dare you? My baby is dead and I want it dead.
And apparently he hates the series. He absolutely hates Friday the 13th. Like, he obviously likes what he's done, but other than that, he absolutely hates it. Like, I was reading an interview where he was like, I hate watched the most recent remake. And he was like, oh, just the anger. What have they done to my creation?
That's quite cool, actually. Because, I mean, I've never been a huge fan of Friday the 13th and the entirety. I think my favorite one is like Jason X, where it's in space because it's just ludicrous. So I think it's quite cool, actually, in a way that he doesn't like the series, because I guess for him, you know, I actually personally think Friday the 13th would be a better film if they had just done Friday the 13th as a one-off and it didn't become this thing. And I know that Jason Voorhees is, you know, he is an iconic character, but it's an effective film by itself without a continuation. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that end scene, that shit me up when I saw it. I was like, no, I was like, what the hell is this? So,
It's, I mean, I just watched the final chapter there yesterday and I really like it. But again, just for his effects.
Yeah.
And you can tell that it was really a labor of love for him. It was, you know, he was about to kill his baby, literally about to kill his baby. And just, it's so brutal. Have you seen the final chapter?
I haven't seen the final chapter, no.
Okay. It's very, the way he dies is very, very brutal. And obviously, Corey Feldman is the one that kills him. And then he goes on to do two more sequels after that. You're just like, stop.
maybe I'll give that one a go just because Savini hates the series, but he did that one. Maybe that's the way to do it, is, you know, miss, forget all the rest.
And I haven't watched two or three. I went from one to four.
I feel like we're honoring him if we just don't watch the ones that he doesn't like. It's like, you know, we're behind you, Tom. We've got you.
We're there, Grandad Tom. We're there.
Whatever you say, Grandad Tom.
I hope this doesn't turn into like a weird kink thing on the internet where people are like, ew, these women were saying like Tom Savini's granddad.
And then it gets to him and, you know, we end up a convention and it's like, we gotta leave with our t-shirts on that obviously are like Tom granddad Tom Savini club.
Oh, I need that t-shirt. But yes, definitely watch the fourth chapter just for kind of closing the book on it. And, you know, you can really tell by that point, Tom Savini has just perfected the visceral gore that is needed in slashers. So would you recommend Friday the 13th to people?
I don't love it as a film, purely because it's not my vibe, but I had a lot of fun with it. I was cracking up at some of the things in there, more because obviously they're all a bit dumb, but I would recommend Friday the 13th. I think you know, Tom Savini's work in it, although he says The Burning he perfected it or whatever he says, I think actually it's way more effective in this. And I think, you know, for the decapitation alone and also for the horrific look of Jason, that monster child out of the water, which I hate I would highly recommend it.
I definitely think Friday the 13th is more effective with displaying his talents rather than how much gore can we get in this film, and, you know, like The Burning is. So I definitely, for me personally, I'd recommend Friday the 13th over The Burning.
Yeah, absolutely.
not just because, you know, it's a classic or what has been portrayed as a classic. And I think everyone needs to see, especially when we think about the history of horror, we need to see what it was like in the 80s. And it's important to watch, you know, films that were big hits or, you know, became classics, but also just to see Tom Savini's work.
Yeah, Yeah, I think more so than anything, really.
Yeah, and then go watch Creepshow and Dawn of the Dead and Day of the Dead and everything else he did. And he actually, he directed the remake of Night of the Living Dead. Did you know that?
That was it. Yes, yeah. I saw that because that was, I was like, oh, I wasn't, yeah, I was thinking about maybe choosing that one, but then I wanted to choose something for his special effects. Yeah. I was like, seeing as I know him for that, let's...
Yeah.
And I chose The Burning, so goddamn my choices.
Well, we dissected it so other people wouldn't have to view it.
Except for all of the people that love it. So they're probably going to watch it again. But no judging. I'm not really judging.
No, go watch his other films instead. So before we finish up here, I always ask, what is your favorite horror film?
Favorite horror film ever? I usually try to go like mainstream because I hate upsetting people with my picks, but because you mentioned it earlier, my favorite horror film is actually Necromantic.
Okay.
I adore that film. I think it's, I mean, it's messed up, that's for sure. But I think it's just, a perfect example of the fact that extreme horror films can be beautiful, yet really uncomfortable and disturbing and controversial.
Yeah.
I don't think extreme always has to be just about, you know,
blood and guts.
Exactly. I think there's so much deeper to it.
Yeah.
And that film, the effects are incredible, out of this world effects. Necromantic is my favorite, absolutely.
I really liked it because it kind of made me, you know, obviously the subject matter, if you tell, I was telling my sister about it and she was like, what? What? No, I was just like, no, bear with me. But it kind of makes you look at this very terrible subject matter that, you know, is probably the worst thing you could do after murdering someone, you know. It's still very taboo. You know, it's if when someone's even talking about true crime, if you mention necrophilia, people kind of be like, oh.
I genuinely think like necrophilia is even more of a taboo than certain other things like animal, like bestiality and things like that. It seems to just be that we cannot wrap our, and fair enough, you know, we just cannot wrap our minds around how one person would have this sexual urge towards a dead body. I mean, it's, you know, it's, I love serial killers, but when I listen, I'm just like, how, what is it that compels someone? And I think, obviously Necromantic does such a fantastic job at, you know, it's not just a body, also it's a skeleton, and it's also a couple bringing it in as this like third thing. And, you know, poor Rob, his girlfriend leaves him for the dead body. And, you know, I was like, that's just sad, man. Yeah. I was like, you poor little thing.
But it has this strange way of making us look at it in a different light. It's not, I mean, it's terrible and it's, you know, a little bit sick, but like, you look at it, as we said earlier, in a romantic view, a tragic romantic view, and it's strange. And I love films that make you flip certain views that you have on subjects like necrophilia, and it flips it and you're like, hang on, no, I'm not meant to be having these feelings. I'm not meant to be like, you know.
I was like I don't think anyone's ever made love to me like that. I was like, that's just so touching.
Find you a love like that.
I know, I mean, how, I mean, I don't want to get arrested or anything, but
And what is the scariest film you've ever seen that still like gives you the creeps, still freaks you out?
Oh, scary film. That is a good question. You know what, a film that really scares me, and I know everyone is probably going to be like, what? Paranormal Activity scares the shit out of me. Yeah. And I still find it frightening. It makes me jump and I think for me, anything that makes me jump is always going to frighten me.
Yeah.
And ghosts scare the hell out of me.
Yeah.
And that film, yeah, even now I put on, I'm like, no, I don't like this. It's too creepy. I hate, you know, the thought of there just being something there. So yeah, that's a bit of a movie that I don't like to admit, but that still scares me.
Yeah, I think it's the fact that it's in, you know, what should be a safe space, which is your home.
Yeah.
And it's not something you can control. It's not an intruder that you can call the police or run away or fight. It's literally something you cannot do anything about. You are fucked.
Yeah. Like, yeah, exactly. It's like, yeah. And yeah, I think as well, you know, kind of that found footage. Mm. I mean, I personally find found footage is probably the genre that scares me the most.
Yeah.
And I think seeing that, I mean, I saw that at the cinema and I was like, nah, well, I was like, I'm done. I was like, I'm over the world. I can't be dealing with this kind of stuff ever going on. But I mean, I think it's a fantastic film. I think it's a really great film, which gets a lot of hate for I don't know what reasons, I guess. People just too scared by it.
Yeah, I found footage gets a lot of heat for stuff, and like I think it's quite, when it's done well, it's done brilliantly. Like, yeah.
If you haven't seen The Borderlands,
that is
you have seen it because you actually mentioned it on one of your previous episodes.
I did, yeah. The Christianity versus pagan one.
Yeah.
That creeps me out. Yeah.
I honestly haven't revisited that because I'm like, I'm not sure I can handle it. I'm good.
You're like, I'm okay. So thank you very much for being on the podcast and dissecting Granddad Tom Savini's work with me.
Thank you so much. And I can't wait till we have our t-shirts.
Yay. So that was my chat there with Zoe Smith, or Zobo with a Shotgun, about two Tom Savini films. Well, they're not Tom Savini films. They're films that Tom Savini worked the special effects makeup on. So that was 1980's Friday the 13th, directed by Sean S. Cunningham, and The Burning, a 1981 slasher film directed by Tony Malin. So, as always, if you would like to give me your two cents about Tom Savini, do you love him? Do you hate him? Are you just a bit meh about him? Do you think there are better films that we could have talked about in relation to Tom Savini's art? So as always, get in touch with us on Instagram or Facebook, What a Scream Podcast, or on email at whatascreampodcast@gmail.com, and we are also on Letterboxd, where you can keep up with previously discussed films and films that we will be discussing in the future. So as always, I hope you're staying safe, and I hope you're taking care of yourselves, and stay horrific. Goodbye. Shouldn't be scared of the Dracula. Shouldn't be scared of the-